Hi everyone, I'm Julian from imperix, and this video is the third part of the introduction to our ACG Software Development Kit. This video is dedicated to the experimental validation of the control of a buck converter that we've developed in the first two parts. In particular, we'll see how to build a converter prototype with imperix power modules, and how to operate a B-box controller with the code that is automatically generated from our previous Simulink model. The converter itself will be built with a PB8032 half-bridge module connected to a DC voltage source and passive components. As in simulation in part 2, the measured quantities are the input and output voltages, which will here be measured by imperix external voltage sensors, and the output current, which is measured by the current sensor embedded on the power module. The only input to the system is the firing signal of the upper switch, and obviously in this buck application there's no firing signal for the lower switch, as we use only its anti-parallel diode. The equipment used is mounted in this cabinet and contains one B-box RCP controller, one rack with 6 half-bridge power modules, and we'll use only the first one, and a filter box from which we'll use only one inductor. On the rear side, the input and output voltages are measured by the external voltage sensors, and the load components are connected to the output of the converter. On the front side, the PWM signal is output on the first optical lane of the B-box and connected to the power module, and the measurements are connected to the first three analog inputs of the device. Speaking of the analog front end of the B-box, it needs to be configured according to the sensor parameters and the operating voltage and currents. The parameters to consider here are the sensor sensitivity and the configuration of the channel input impedance, the analog scaling gain, and the operating limits of the measured quantity. At any time, and independently of the running control algorithm, if one of the limits is reached, the operation of the converter is immediately stopped. Each analog channel of the B-box is then configured using the Rotary button. Now let's go back to our Simulink model. The first thing I will do is to replace the step block that was used to generate reference steps in simulation by a tunable parameter that we will be able to change while the controller is running. I will also configure the ADC blocks to match the parameters of the sensor that we are using and to transfer the parameters that we've just configured on the B-box front panel. For instance, on channel 0, we can load the predefined parameters of the external voltage sensor and specify the scaling gain of 8 times. Then we do the same for the channels 1 and 2. Now we can generate code from that model and execute it on a B-box controller. In the configuration block, we want to change the execution purpose from simulation to automated code generation. This will replace the simulation model of the library blocks by real code instructions that will typically read or write on the real peripherals of the controller. Then all we need to do is to click the Build button. This will use Simulink Coder to generate code from the Simulink model, and then the toolchain included in ACG SDK will automatically build the code, create an executable, and launch the BB Control utility software. From there, make sure that your controller is connected to your computer via Ethernet. This can be either directly or through a local network, and connect by entering the IP address displayed on its screen. Once connected, BB Control will automatically load the executable onto the controller and execute it. The B-box will show running once it's done. Although the CUD is running, this doesn't mean that the converter is already operating. We'll see later how to start the converter. What we can do now is to display our variables. Those are the signals of the Simulink model that are connected to a probe block, and those coming from a tunable parameter block. You can then log those variables in real time by dragging them on the plot below. In this case here, I will display the input voltage on the top scope and the output voltage along with its reference value on the bottom scope. This allows me to keep an eye on these variables at any time. Now, before starting the converter, I will charge my input DC bus at 100 volts. From there, I can start the operation of the converter by clicking the Enable Outputs button. This will start to generate PWM outputs and thus allow power to flow in the converter. The B-box will display front panel locked and the core LED will turn green to indicate that the converter is operating. In our case here, our output voltage reference is still zero, so there's no power flow yet. But when I set the reference to 50 volts, the converter starts switching as seen on the oscilloscope, and the output voltage is controlled at 50 volts as seen on the bottom plot. Similarly, when reverting the reference back to zero, the output voltage falls to zero. Now let's say we want to observe the dynamic behavior of our converter. Using the data logging tab of BB Control, we can display each and every sample of all our variables like we would on an oscilloscope. And here I will configure my trigger on the rising edge of the voltage reference and display it with the output voltage. So when I step from 0 to 50 volts, the data logging displays the transient response of the system. The same response can be observed with a real oscilloscope. For instance, if you'd like to observe the high frequency current ripples with a current probe, it is required to use a real oscilloscope. In this case, you can output the voltage reference on one of the analog outputs, connect it to the oscilloscope, and trigger the oscilloscope on the rising edge of that voltage reference. This way, when you change the reference, you can observe the transient response of the system. Finally, I'll show you another way to generate more advanced transients to challenge your system. In the Data Logging tab, enable the Transient Generator, and in the Transient sub-tab, you can configure your event within the acquisition window. In our case, the output voltage reference is the only input variable, so we'll create three steps of the same variable. But in another system, you could change any variable at any time. Here we will jump from 0 to 50 volts after 50 samples of the acquisition window, and then back to 0, and finally up to 80 volts. At the end of the acquisition window, namely after 1000 samples, the reference is reset at its initial value. So now, as soon as I click the force trigger button, the reference is changed according to the defined events. Once you're happy with the result, you can export each and every displayed sample in a CSV file and easily post-process your results to your liking in MATLAB. This is a very efficient way of generating easily and rapidly quality experimental results for your publications. Before ending this video, let me quickly show you two more examples of more complex systems that have been implemented using the same principle as this tutorial. Here you can see an example of direct door control of a permanent magnet motor implemented in Simulink and tested on an experimental test bench. And the second example shows a complete MMC converter with 8 submodules per phase. The whole control algorithm, including the submodule voltage balancing, has been implemented in Simulink and runs on 3 stacked B-box controllers. Well, that's it for this video. Thanks for watching. And if you have any questions, please have a look at our website or write to our support team.